Everybody, today, welcome back to the NEEM seminar series. Today, the talk is going to be given by Dr. Deepak Vaid. He is at NIT in Karnataka, in Suratkal. He's a faculty there. Deepak did his PhD at Penn State and then came back to join as a faculty position. He's very much interested in all kinds of quantum gravity, and today he's going to tell us about quantum error correlations in loop quantum gravity. If you have very urgent questions for Deepak, you can raise hand. Otherwise, as usual, we will have all the questions right at the end of the talk. Deepak, you can please carry on.
Okay, thank you, sir. So good afternoon, everybody. Thank you so much for taking the time to come here. So I realize that most people at IUCA are not high energy theory experts. So I will try to explain the necessary background. But of course, that is why I have asked Professor Kandasamy to allow questions during the talk, because again, this topic is somewhat new for most of you, most likely. So please don't hesitate to raise your hand if you have any questions during the talk. So I'm going to talk about the connection between two topics. One is in quantum information or quantum computation. That is the topic of quantum error correction. And I'm going to talk about how quantum error correction exists, or quantum error correcting codes exist in the framework of, in the approach of, towards quantum gravity, which is known as loop quantum gravity. So most of you, I'm sure, have heard of something called the ADS-CFT correspondence or holography. So some of the motivation for trying to understand the role played by quantum error correcting codes in quantum gravity comes from the ADS-CFT side of things. So first I will give you some of the background required to understand that. And then I will briefly talk about what quantum error correcting codes are and what information you need to know to understand the work that I'm going to talk about. And then I'm going to talk about the state space of loop quantum gravity, which is in terms of these objects called spin networks. And then I will explain how these quantum error correcting codes arise naturally as elements of this state space. So what is this ADS-CFT correspondence? It basically tells us that we have a space-time, which is anti-de Sitter space-time. So that's basically a solution of Einstein's equations with a negative cosmological constant. And this metric can be written in this form. And this space-time has a boundary. So, and that because it has a boundary, on that boundary, there's a certain set of symmetry. The symmetry of the boundary turn out to be that of the conformal group. So if you look at ADS if you look at the Penrose diagram of anti-de Sitter space-time, it looks like a cylinder where here R is zero and this is R is equal to infinity. And the vertical arrow is time. And this sigma denotes a spatial slice, a constant time slice. And if one looks at a constant time slice, the metric of ADS can be represented in terms of this structure, which is this is actually one of the woodcut paintings by M.C. Escher, who's famous for his paradoxical images. And so you can see that this tiling starts out in the center. As you go outwards radially, it keeps getting more and more crowded. And that is reflected in the fact that this radial area element, it has a 1/r² dependence. So as you keep going outwards, even though r is increasing to infinity, you don't have to travel an infinite distance, so to speak, to reach the boundary. This whole geometry can be viewed as a hyperboloid, so which is embedded in a higher dimensional flat space. So in the same way that you can think, you know, you can think of a sphere as being embedded in S2 being embedded in R3, you can think of in this case ADS4 as being embedded in R5. And when you look at this expression of this embedding equation, why it is manifestly clear by just by looking at it that it has a symmetry group which corresponds to SO32. SO32 happens to be the group of conformal symmetry. And so this is why the boundary of ADS has this conformal symmetry. So what the ADS-CFT correspondence tells us is that in the bulk of ADS, in the interior over here, one has a gravity theory, something that satisfies Einstein's equation. And on the boundary, one has a field theory. And this field theory has a conformal symmetry, so it's a conformal field theory. And what the ADS-CFT correspondence tells us is that this field theory can be corresponds to.
Hello, yes, sir, Santosh. I just noticed that. I think so. He has.
Sorry, Santosh, you have something. Hello. Okay. All right. So. So the field theory on the boundary, one can define correlation functions on the field theory, and the correspondence tells us that those correlation functions can be equated to the partition function of bulk fields in the ADS geometry. So what we are interested in normally is we are interested in non-trivial and ADS spacetimes. So for example, this is the ADS Schwarzschild metric. And it has the same similar form to the ADS metric with the difference that this function f has this term which looks like the Schwarzschild, usual Schwarzschild term. Now, so what this term does is, so this is a Schwarzschild black hole of radius r and it's embedded in ADS. So as you go out towards the boundary of ADS, so in this case, in these coordinates, as you go from to r is equal to infinity, what will happen is this term will eventually fall off to zero and you'll be left with an asymptotically ADS spacetime. And now we know from the Bekenstein-Hawking work of Hawking, Bekenstein and others, that if you have a black hole has an associated temperature, right? And that temperature is given by 1/4 times the surface gravity, right? So the surface gravity of a black hole or any gravitational object is the acceleration required, basically the acceleration due to gravity at the surface of that object. And since the black hole has a temperature, that tells us that the field theory on the boundary also has a temperature. And in this case, that temperature corresponds to the temperature of the black hole. Now, what makes this ADS-CFT correspondence really interesting is not just that it allows us to calculate quantities in conformal field theories in terms of gravitational observables or vice versa, but that it tells us something very fundamental about quantum gravity per se. And these developments were ignited primarily by a major famous paper from about 12 years, which is about 12 years old now, written by Shinsei Ryu and Tadashi Takayanagi. And that paper so contains what is known as the Ryu-Takayanagi formula. So to explain the Ryu-Takayanagi formula, if you look at this circle, so this circle is like a spatial slice of antitransitor space at a fixed time, right? So the interior of this space, we have a Einstein's equation, we have antidissiter, and you can have black holes or whatever else living in the bulk. And the boundary circle is where your conformal field theory is living. And in this picture, what has been done is this circle has been partitioned into two segments. So one is A and the other is the complement of A. Now, since we have some sort of quantum mechanical degrees of freedom living on these boundaries, one of the things that we can do is we can ask what is the entanglement between the degrees of freedom, the quantum mechanical degrees of freedom living on A with those living on A bar. And the one way to quantify this entanglement is by asking what is the entanglement entropy between these two regions. So this entanglement entropy can be written if you have rho AA bar, which is the density matrix of the whole system, and you take a trace over, let's say you take a trace over A bar, then you will get the entropy of entanglement entropy of S of A. And what Ryu Takenagi said is that what they noted is that this entropy of entanglement between this boundary region and this boundary region can be written in terms of a certain area element of a certain surface, which is this gamma A. And that gamma A is this surface which runs through the bulk of the ADS spacetime. And it is anchored on the boundary at the points which connect the two regions A and A bar. And this surface happens to be the extremal surface because of the properties of ADS. So there is a certain surface which is an extremal surface. And this surface has a certain area. And so they said, well, the entanglement entropy between these two regions corresponds to this area. Now, the thing that makes this development really significant is further work done by Mark von Ramstorck and Brian Swingel in 2009 onwards. So Ramstorck's argument is the most powerful and convenient way of understanding the significance of the RT formula. So you imagine that you have, again, you have some spacetime, some bulk spacetime, and then there are two boundary regions here, tilde A and tilde B, and A and B are the bulk regions corresponding to these boundaries. And you have some surface S, which divides this boundary, which divides this bulk into two pieces, right? So according to the Ryu Takenagi formula, the amount of entanglement between A tilde and B tilde is proportional to the area of this surface. So now one can perform a thought experiment in which you take this surface and you slowly shrink it. Now, as you shrink this surface, what one is doing is we are reducing its area. Now, as we reduce its area, what happens is that we, according to the RT formula, we are reducing the entanglement between the green boundary and the blue boundary. And one can imagine continuing this process until the surface goes to zero area. And when that happens, what happens is that the bulk region A and the bulk region B, they separate into two completely disconnected parts, right? So you have two separate disconnected geometries. And now there is no entanglement left because, well, the area has gone to zero. There is no entanglement between the green boundary and the blue boundary. So what the RT formula is telling us is that geometry itself, that means the connectivity between different regions of spacetime, is related to entanglement of certain degrees of freedom living on the boundaries of the spacetime. So it is telling us that entanglement, geometry arises from entanglement. So now, coming back to the ADS-CFT correspondence, this is a fundamental expression of the ADS-CFT correspondence, where the left-hand side tells us that we have the partition function of certain fields living in the bulk, and on the right-hand side we have the partition function of fields which are living on the boundary. And so phi is some bulk field and O is some operator living in the boundary, which is given by this ADS-CFT dictionary. There is a corresponding operator for each bulk field. And according to this correspondence, if one takes the limit r goes to infinity, that means as you go towards the boundary, these two quantities match. That means if I calculate the partition function of the gravity theory, it will be equal to the partition function of the boundary conformal theory. But the issue with this is that this equality only holds asymptotically, that means as r goes to infinity. So then the question arises, is it possible to construct bulk fields? That means if you are in the interior of ADS, far away from the boundary, can you reconstruct what is going on in the interior from knowledge of this boundary fields? And so it turns out that one can indeed do that, as shown by several authors, Hamilton, Cabot, and others, that one can write down, given, so this is the field phi naught defined on the boundary, and there is a certain kernel function, and this is the field which is living in the bulk. So r is the radial coordinate, x is the coordinate which is transverse to r, so the coordinate along. So if you have surfaces which are parallel to the boundary, x would be the coordinate on that surface. And so one can reconstruct these fields if one knows both of these quantities, and we can solve for them explicitly. But the issue is that if you look at this expression involves an integration over the boundary. So it is telling us that this bulk field phi at some point r and x in the bound in the bulk is related to this integral of all of these fields over the entire boundary region. So what that means is that local bulk fields are dual to non-local boundary operators, right? So you need knowledge of the fields on the entire boundary to reconstruct the bulk theory. So then people started to ask, well, is it possible to make this requirement less restrictive? Instead of needing the information on the entire boundary, is it possible that if I just want to, looking at this, this is the ADS cylinder again on the right-hand side. The sigma is the space-like slice. X is a point in the bulk. And so what was realized by various people, including Veronica, Yupani, Mukund Rangamani, and others, was that to reconstruct the fields at this point X, one doesn't need the knowledge of the boundary theory everywhere, but only on a certain segment of the boundary, which is known as the causal wedge or the entanglement wedge. So that means you have this boundary point X, and you consider all of the rays which leave this region, which leave this point, and which are coming into this point, and you consider the intersection of these rays with the boundary. And this shaded green region on the boundary, this is called the entanglement wedge. And as long as you know the operators on this entanglement wedge, it is sufficient to construct whatever is going on at this point X. So looking at this spatial slice from the sort of a top view, you have this point X and you have this region of the boundary A. And so this part of sigma is called the entanglement wedge of this region A. And this surface again is that extremal root Takanagi surface that I talked about earlier. So now this presents us with another interesting point, which is that if I want to reconstruct the fields at this point X, I can use this fields on this segment. But then there is a certain ambiguity. And why is there an ambiguity? Well, because if you look at this point X, and I look at two different regions, well, this is one region A, and another boundary segment B. And A and B have some finite overlap, but they are not the same. Now, X lies within the entanglement wedge of both boundary segment A and boundary segment B. So that means I can reconstruct, according to the entanglement wedge reconstruction, I can reconstruct the fields here using knowledge only about the fields on A or using knowledge only about the fields on B. But now if I ask, so X lies in the intersection of the entanglement wedge of these two segments. But if you look at the operators which have support only in A, and those which have support only on B, in order for this to be a consistent reconstruction, the operators which allow me to reconstruct X should have support only on the boundary region which corresponds to the intersection of A with B.
Deepak, can I interrupt you for a minute?
Yes, sir.
You said the boundary region which is required information from is something like where the light rays go in the past and future and intersect the boundary.
Yes, sir.
But then that would be unique. How can you have two, A and B, to which the light rays propagate?
So you're right, but you can have more than one. The point X can lie in more than, so if you look at this diagram, let me go back. If you look at this diagram here, right. So the point X, right, lies within this shaded green region, right?
Yes.
And the entanglement wedge is not the entanglement wedge of this point, but the entanglement wedge corresponds to this boundary segment and the associated RT surface. So this RT surface has a unique entanglement wedge. You consider all the points, all the rays coming out of the boundary of this RT surface as they're going up and intersecting the ADS boundary. So I misspoke earlier when I said the rays are coming out of the point.
It's coming out of that RT surface.
Mm-hmm. And X is within. Now you can imagine taking this segment and shifting it a little bit.
Thank you.
Okay, no problems. And so because of this inconsistency, what this means is that the operators which have support on A can not be equal to the operators which have support on B. But we can see that that is obviously not going to be true. So this tells us that there is no unique way, there is no unique reconstruction of this of the bulk fields at this point X, right? And this is where these people, Almeri, Dong, and Harlow, made their conceptual leap and pointed out that this has the same structure as that of quantum error correcting code. So how is that? Well, if you have an error correcting code, what that means is you have some information and you want to make that information immune to errors. So let me first tell you a little bit about quantum error correcting codes, then I will come back to that and tell you how it corresponds to this. So in any computation, errors are inevitable, but error correction protocols have therefore been built. So there are error correction protocols which are responsible for, which make this sort of video communication possible, for instance. Otherwise, we would have so many glitches that it would not be possible at all. But in the background, all of these protocols are working and they are making sure that if there are any bits which have errors in them, those bits are thrown away and then retransmitted. And so the way this works is that you take a certain logical C bit, classical bit, or a logical qubit, and you encode it in terms of more than one, several physical C bits or qubits. And this is basically the notion of safety through redundancy. So the simplest example of this, for instance, is a repetition code where one takes a logical zero and embeds it in three different bits. And one takes a logical one and embeds it in three different bits. Now, three different bits can have a total of 8 states. And what we are saying is that the 000 state corresponds to this, to the logical zero, and the 111 state corresponds to the logical one. And all the rest we don't care about. Now, as long as only one of these bits is flipped by whatever error there is, okay? So we have some assumption on the sort of errors. So if I imagine flipping one of the bits here, then the person on the other end can look at the other two bits and say that, well, okay, the sender must have been trying to send me one, right? So he or she can perform the necessary correction to restore the information into its original value. So quantum error correcting codes work similarly, though there's a more complicated protocol which is required for measuring the parity of these states, because of the fact that if you measure the quantum state, you also collapse it. So one needs certain ancillary bits, and one needs there's an algorithm for that. But if you use those algorithms, then you can correct these errors. And the formal definition of a quantum error correcting code is of this form. An NK quantum error correcting code refers to a certain triple, where there is a certain code space, which is a K-dimensional subspace of some higher dimensional physical Hilbert space. So for example, in the previous case, you had a physical Hilbert space consisting of 3 qubits and a code subspace, which is corresponds to only these two states, 000 and 111. And then you have a certain set of quantum operations on the physical Hilbert space, which generate errors. So for example, it could be bit flip operations or phase flip operations. And then there will be a certain set of quantum operations which can undo those errors. Now, in the context of the ADS-CFT bulk reconstruction picture, the way it works is that, so let me go back to that picture again, is that the information that is present at these bulk fields, at this point X, in the neighborhood of this point X, now this information is coded into this boundary in a redundant manner. What does that mean? We can use the information at A to reconstruct whatever happens at X, or we can use the information at B to reconstruct whatever happens at X. So that means even if some portion of the boundary information is lost, or if it's corrupted due to some error, I can still use the remaining information to reconstruct whatever happens here. So what it's basically telling us is that the way that bulk geometry or bulk space-time exists is that the degrees of freedom at any given point that you observe, they are not quote-unquote physical degrees of freedom. They correspond to the code subspace. They correspond to the logical degrees of freedom. And there are always errors which can corrupt whatever underlying code there is. But because quantum error correcting codes are built into the structure of space-time itself, that is the reason that we can observe a consistent reality at all. Otherwise, we would have the same situation with reality as we would with, let's say, using a video conference without error correcting codes. Everything would be glitchy, and we wouldn't have this sense of stable, continuous existence around us. So this was all outlined in a seminal set of papers by Almir A. Dong and Harlow in 2015, and followed up very quickly by others like Preskill, Pestowski, Yoshida, and many others. So the interpretation is that the physical Hilbert space corresponds to the CFT degrees of freedom living on the boundary, on the ADS boundary. And the code subspace, which is a subspace of this physical Hilbert space, corresponds to what we observed as semi-classical bulk states of geometry. So the physical Hilbert space is very, very large. It includes lots of states, but not all of those states would correspond to valid semi-classical states of geometry, right? So only the code subspace in a certain sense, encodes the bulk semi-classical geometry states. So now let me just briefly mention a certain quantum error correcting code, which is known as Shor's 9-qubit code. And in this code, we have something like 9 qubits, that's why it's 9-qubit code, as a physical sub-Hilbert space. And our logical qubits are encoded. So one logical qubit requires 9 physical qubits. And you can see that the basic ingredient of Shor's 9-qubit code are states of this form, 0, 0, 0, 1, 1, 1. And these are also known in the quantum parlance as catch states. Because if you imagine 0, 0, 0, that could be, if you imagine instead of 3 qubits, you imagine 50 qubits, and you say all the states are 0, or all of them are 1, and then one, you can think of the 0, 1 as the cat being dead, and the 1 being the cat being alive. And if you want to generate these such sort of states, starting from individual unentangled qubits, then you can use a certain quantum circuit, which looks like this, which takes individual unentangled qubits as inputs. So this takes in a certain qubit in a superposition alpha beta, and this is just a zero state and zero state. So these 3 qubits, there is no entanglement or correlation between them to begin with. Then this set of operations here, this corresponds to a C not gate. And this corresponds to another C not gate, controlled not. So these two C not gates, when they act in sequence, they take these uncorrelated states and spit out this catch state. So it's a superposition of this zeros and ones. Then you can see that this is an entangled state. And the reason I'm mentioning this is because in the context of loop quantum gravity, I will talk about how these sort of states can be generated in spin networks. So now let me briefly give you a very, very fast history of loop quantum gravity. So this is the non-perturbative canonical quantum gravity program, which was initiated by Abhay Ashikar's famous work on the new variables for classical and quantum gravity. And then very quickly, Rovelli, Carlo Rovelli, Lee Smolin, Lewandowski, Krasnov, Friedel, John Baez, Barrett Crane, and many others have contributed over the years, over the past 30 years, to the development of this field. So the basic idea is that you start with general relativity, and we all know what the many problems general relativity has in terms of trying to quantize it as a normal field theory. So what Ashikar did is that realized is that, well, if you can write gravity as a gauge theory instead of treating it as a theory of a metric field, then perhaps we could use all the knowledge that we have acquired in quantizing Maxwell and Young-Mills fields, which are gauge fields also. And we have very successfully quantized them, right? We have a theory of QCD, for example, and QVD. So if we can write gravity as a gauge theory, then we can use those techniques to try to construct a quantum theory of gravity. So Ashikar was the first person to write down this expression of general relativity, the action, Einstein-Hilbert action, in terms of a certain SL2C gauge connection and a tetrad. And then the next step is to perform a 3+1, or the ADM splitting. And when you perform an ADM splitting, your Einstein-Hilbert action gets converted into a sum of 3 different terms. And these 3 terms are all constraints. The one is called the diffeomorphism, or the vector constraint. Another is called the Gauss constraint. And the third is the Hamiltonian constraint. And it turns out that using this loop quantization procedure, one can construct states which are exact solutions of the diffeomorphism and Gauss constraint. And these states are known as spin networks. And the Hamiltonian constraint is what it's a generator of time evolution. So you start with the data on a three-dimensional slice, and to evolve it, you need to use the Hamiltonian constraint. So it turns out that there are certain structures called spin forms, which are four-dimensional histories of geometry. And these spin forms are solutions of the Hamiltonian constraint. And spin networks can be seen as boundary states of these spin forms. So all of this has been established very concretely in numerical and analytical work. So a lot of the time you will hear many people talk about how there are problems with loop quantum gravity, you don't have a notion of how space-time is. And most of those objections are very overblown. Through a very nice analysis, we can see how the classical Einstein-Hilbert action emerges from the spin network or spin form picture. But of course, there are many questions which remain to be answered. So spin networks, what are these spin networks? They're basically graph states. So a graph is a collection of vertices connected by one-dimensional edges. And these edges are labeled by certain objects which are representations of SU2. The reason it is SU2 is because you start with an SL2C connection, that is a four-dimensional object, and then you restrict down to a spatial surface. And when you restrict to a spatial surface, your SL2C reduces to SU2. So these are SU2 spins which are living on the edges of this network. And the vertices are labeled by certain invariant tensors, SU2 tensors. They are called intertwiners. And these vertices are associated with quanta of volume. So one can rigorously write down a volume operator and find its eigenvalues, and you find that the volume operator has a minimum lower bound. Similarly, each edge is associated with a quantum of area. So imagine an abstract surface which is punctured by this edge, and that abstract surface is endowed with an area which is given by this Casimir of the spin carried by this edge. And you can construct macroscopic surfaces by imagining an ensemble of edges piercing such a surface. And this allows us to do the black hole entropy calculation. And it's very interesting to note historically, again, that string theory, many people think that, well, that is the one and only theory of quantum gravity. But loop quantum gravity did the calculation for black hole entropy before, if not at the same time. Carlo Rovelli did this in 1996. And I think the Strominger-Wafa calculation for the string theory counting of black hole microstates was in 1997. And the Rovelli calculation is very simple. It is stunningly simple, whereas the Strominger-Wafa calculation requires a lot of knowledge about BPS states and such things. And it also applies only to certain extremal black holes, whereas the Rovelli calculation applies to ordinary Schwarzschild black holes. So now, let me talk about the key point, which is where do these quantum error correcting codes come in the context of spin networks? So when you have a spin network, so this is a sort of a representation. You have some edges coming into this region. These dotted lines represent two certain compact regions, and they are connected by these two edges in the middle. Now, like I said, the spin networks are solutions of the diffeomorphism constraint. What does that mean? That means that if I move the edges, if I take this edge and I wiggle it a little bit this way or that way, my quantum state will remain the same. In terms of a classical three-dimensional geometry, it means that my state is invariant under diffeomorphisms. But now, apart from small diffeomorphisms, in general relativity and in other gauge theories, one also has the concept of large diffeomorphisms. And large diffeomorphisms are those which are not connected to the identity. So if you imagine taking these two edges and winding them around each other. Now, if you look at these two configurations, one cannot smoothly deform these edges in any way such that one could go from this configuration to this one or vice versa. But this is also a valid state because it's connected to this state by a large gauge transformation, not a small one. So these are like the theta sectors of Young-Mills theory. And if you look at this picture in a slightly different perspective, you have these two regions, V1, and where this edge punctures this surface, we have given it a label V1 and a label V2. And at the other surface, it's with some primes. And now we imagine switching these two edges, right, performing a permutation. So now what happens is that we know from two-dimensional many-body physics that in quantum mechanics, when you take two particles and you permute them, what that does is it performs a unitary operation on the associated Hilbert space. And this unitary operation can be represented as a braid operation in terms of some R matrix acting on the Hilbert space of the two qubits. So here the analog would be to say that wherever this surface is punctured by an edge, we have a qubit living on that surface. And so we have these two qubits living here, and they are being permuted by the behavior of these edges. And this is in the in the quantum theory, how would we represent this? One would represent this as a unitary operator. And so the statement is that my claim is that this quantum diffeomorphism operator corresponds to a quantum gate, but the form of this R matrix is not yet determined. To determine the form of this R matrix, we can look at something else. We can look at something which is known as the Rademeister moves. So now you imagine that you have three such edges. So you have three qubits living on the edges, ends of these edges. And you have three such edges. And you have two different configurations of these edges. Now, if you look at these two carefully, I mean, I suppose most of you don't have the time to do that right away. But if you do, what you will see is that you can move these edges, you can slide them one over the other so that these two are actually the same. That means you don't need a large gauge transformation. There is no change in this linking or knotting. And this identity can be represented as this expression, where sigma 1 tells us that the first edge braids over the second edge, sigma 2 tells us that the second edge braids over the third edge, and then finally sigma 1 again. Or we can do in a different order. We can do sigma 1, sigma 2, 1, and sigma 2. So this expression can be written as an operator equation. So here, sigma 1, for instance, becomes R tensor 1, where R is the braiding operator acting on the first two qubits and identity on the third one. And then the second step, we have one tensor R, which is the sigma 2, and then sigma 1 again. And when you look at this expression, this is an operator expression equation, and this is known as the Yang-Baxter equation. So this is a very famous equation from statistical mechanics. And Lomonoko and Stuart Kaufman in 2004, in a very amazing paper, what they showed is that there is a unique solution for this R matrix, which can be obtained by solving this Yang-Baxter equation. And this R matrix is nothing more than a C naught gate. And I've drawn the C naught gate vertically to make the correspondence with the earlier pictures, because here also everything is shown vertically. So now if you look at a configuration, a braid operation of this form, where you have one and two braiding, and then two and three braiding, well, one can do it's a very simple calculation, and you see that this corresponds to a C naught operation here, and these two together, they correspond to this circuit which I had shown earlier, which takes in three uncorrelated qubits and generates a catch state. So what this shows us is that if we take the statement that these large diffeomorphisms must be a part of the loop quantum gravity state space, then we find that these states, these catch states, must necessarily also be present within our spin network system. And one can go further and one can talk about this concept of universal quantum computation. So now we have this picture of spin networks as representing quantum circuits, basically. And so one can ask, well, is it possible to perform a universal computation with these circuits? So now it is very well known that to perform a universal quantum computation, one needs at least one, a single two-qubit entangling gate. We already have that. That's the R gate, R operator that I talked about. And one needs at least one or more single qubit gates. And so these single qubit gates can be of the form, this is a Hadamard gate or a phase gate or a pi by eight gate. And in the picture that I have just shown you, these gates are not present. So it turns out that if we make another change of framework, and instead of thinking about only spin networks with one-dimensional edges, we take those one-dimensional edges and we broaden them into ribbons. So now they look like two-dimensional surfaces. And there are actually very good reasons for why one has to do this. So if one wants to write, if one wants to have a gauge theory which is well-defined without certain anomalies, you have to work with framed ribbons. So this is due to work that was done by Witten in on the Jones polynomial 30 years ago, and then by Smolin soon thereafter in the context of loop quantum gravity. So if you look at these framed edges, then you can see that these framed edges have another degree of freedom, which is the ability to twist around one axis. And so you can have a twist which goes one way or a twist which goes another way. So one can assign, let's say, a positive charge to one sense of a twist and a negative charge to another sense of a twist. And in general, one can have a configuration which looks like this. We have ribbons which are braided around each other and which also carry these twist charges. There is another degree of freedom which arises from the fact that these braids can cross either over or under each other. So if we associate all of these various degrees of freedom with quantum gates, then one should be able to show that spin networks are universal for quantum computation. What makes this all particularly interesting from my perspective is the fact that in 2005, Nunn, Bilson, Thompson, an Australian researcher, made this remarkable observation that if you consider frame braids and you consider three strand braids, so you have three ribbons, and you consider, so this is the smallest non-trivial braid group. For you need three strands, and this has this three strand braid group only has one element really. But if you take this one element and you consider all possible combinations of these twist charges applied to these ribbons, and you associate a certain electric charge with each twist, you find out that, well, the only possibilities are that you get something which has a charge of one and plus one and minus one, which are related by a mirror reflection. And then the other two possibilities are that you get a charge of plus two or plus two thirds or and plus or minus one third. Then you can also have uncharged braids. And so he identified these with neutrinos and these with the leptons and the quarks. So that is one reason why I find this model particularly compelling, is because I feel that, so all of this work, this was done in 2005, much before Harlow and Zidong and others. And then in 2010, I wrote another paper connecting Wilson Thompson's paper to discrete symmetries in LQG. Again, at that time, there was no mention of quantum error correction or quantum information in quantum gravity. So it is understandable that our work has gone ignored. But after the work that was done by these people, because they come from a string theory background, that naturally gives them much greater exposure. And so there has been a huge amount of media attention. There have been articles in Quantum Magazine and all these other sort of places. And that is fine, justifiably so. Their work is very, very significant and insightful. But I think what is important to note is that their work dovetails beautifully with Wilson Thompson's construction and also with the ideas of surrounding quantum error correction. So to conclude, the full state space of LQG should include knotting and braiding of edges, including small and large diffeomorphisms. The corresponding operator yields is the Yang-Baxter equation. This Yang-Baxter equation naturally leads us to these GFZ states. And moreover, we can identify these we can call them bound states with elementary particles. The reason I call them bound states is because, again, it will require a finite amount of energy to cut a braid and unbraid these configurations. And what is, again, all of this would be mere speculation, but the fact that there is a very striking parallel with the construction of the way the standard model particles are embedded in string theory. So in string theory, you have these D-brains. D-brains are some higher dimensional objects. And on a brain, you can have strings which end on a brain. And so the way that people construct Young-Mills or other gauge theories in the context of string theory is they look at a stack of brains. They look at 1, 2, 3 brains, for example, and they look at the strings which are joining these three brains. And so to my naive eye, this looks exactly the same as the construction that we have in the loop quantum gravity picture. What they are saying is they have these D brains. What we are saying is, well, we have these surfaces in which are being connected by edges. So all of these coincidences and similarities, they cannot all just be mere coincidence. And so thank you for your time. I hope I'm not gone too much over time.
Perfect. Thank you very much, Deepak. Yes. So any questions for Deepak? You can raise your hand in the Zoom window. Okay, I have a couple of...
Yes.
I mean, usually when you are talking about the loop quantum gravity,
yes,
you are not basically describing only geometry part of it and not the matter part, right?
That's exactly the issue that I'm addressing, right? And that is one of the primary criticisms that is directed at loop quantum gravity, and justifiably so.
Yes.
Is that where is the matter?
Yes.
Right? I mean, without matter, how can you call it quantum gravity?
Yes.
Right? And so the problem with the orthodox loop quantum gravity school is they generally have, for some reason, steered clear of all of these topological ideas.
Mm.
And whenever you talk to them about the question of embedding matter, they say, oh, you can do that. You can easily introduce scalar fields, for example, by putting a degree of freedom on each vertex. Or you can introduce Young-Mills fields by just saying that instead of just labeling these edges with SU2, you label them with SU3 and SU2. But in my opinion, that is, again,
But you're trying to build, you're trying to build elementary particles out of the same structure.
Exactly. My point is
the geometry.
Exactly. My point is that these states are already present. And but even they, if you were...
But they all came from the geometric part of the action, because you rewrote the Einstein action in terms of these gauge, in terms of these Ashtaker type variables.
Yes, sir.
And so how is it that you already are thinking that they will form the matter also?
Well, so, okay. I mean, you start from some classical theory, right? And you get some quantum theory, but we know that if you go the reverse way, you won't get exactly the same classical action. You'll get the classical action plus something else, right? You will get some effective action with some quantum correction.
Right. So you would postulate this quantum theory as more fundamental.
Absolutely.
You are saying that when you go back with some twists and rides and raids and, you know, twists, you will get back some new stuff.
Yes, that is my point. And the thing is that there is a marvelous, efficiency or frugality of ingredients in this. And regardless of whether you want to interpret them as elementary particles or not, you cannot ignore the fact that this sector of loop quantum gravity is present. And moreover, that it allows you to show that you can have these what are known as noiseless subsystems, basically, so which are the same as these quantum error correcting codes. Now, there is another sense in which quantum error correcting codes are already present in loop quantum gravity, but for that, I would need another half an hour, 40 minutes.
No problem.
So there are two different senses in which quantum error correction plays a very important role. And then there is a third motivation, which comes from a very interesting work done by Vladimir Koropin and some 15 years ago. So, and what he showed was that if you look at some system which is in thermal equilibrium, then he made this argument that the states which are in thermal equilibrium are elements of some code subspace. So the thing is that if you consider this question of how, excuse me, sir, I'll be right back. One.
Yeah, Induleka, you can ask your question after Deepak is through with.
Yes, sir, I'm back. I just had a small crisis on my hand.
Okay, no problem. Are you okay?
It's okay. I'm fine, sir. I have, like I said, a small crisis. It's okay. Let her come. It's a small 2-year-old crisis.
No problem.
Come. And if she can't come into my door as soon as she wakes up.
Yes. So can maybe Induleka can ask her question, and then we can continue the discussion. Induleka, please go ahead.
It's just a small doubt I have. I have once seen that, you know, Maxwell's equations can be expressed using octonions. And then this is a comment. I was asking about something else, quantum gravity or information or quantum information or something. Then ECG Sudarshan, he told me, you can express using in different ways, but
you
are not getting anything new out of it. Some new, you know, realization, some new physics
So thanks for mentioning this point, because there is actually a completely different line of thought, which, as you said, comes from what are called division algebras. So division algebras correspond to the real numbers, complex numbers, quaternions and octonions, also written as R, C, H and O. And so then there is another physicist called Cole Fury, who has done a lot of remarkable work to show how within this division algebra, one can reconstruct the same pattern of the standard model. So I'm not familiar exactly with the Maxwell Octonian correspondence, but I'm talking about something which is hopefully along the similar lines. And now that work also is quite beautiful on its own. And you know, it should have some correspondence ultimately, because you know, you can't be living in a universe with different theories describing different aspects of matter. But I don't know how that connects to this spin network picture. But
no,
as
no,
far
no,
as
no. What network, I was asking was,
let me tell you. So the thing is that in the spin network picture, we do get something new, right? We get the notion that we have these particles, but these particles are represented, they correspond to certain quantum error correcting codes. So that is a completely new understanding we have, which was not present there before.
So you're giving the particles a new identity and a new role.
Yeah, exactly. So whenever you think of you think of some scattering process, right? Some Feynman diagram. So you know, we can write down the usual amplitudes and all. But now, if you think about it physically, how it actually happens in space time, and you think of this as a computational process. Right, and so if it's a computational process, then there could also be errors in this, in any computational process. But if there were these errors and they were happening, let's say at some Planck scale or some high energy scale, and they kept being propagated to our low energy scales, then we would be again in trouble, right? We would have all sorts of inconsistencies. We would have non-conservation of energy momentum, right? We don't see that, right? We don't see things popping in and out of existence. And the reason I think that we don't see that is because what happens is that these scattering processes, there is quantum error correction is built into these processes.
So are you?
So thank you.
Okay. Is there any other question from anyone else? Okay, I don't think there's any other question, Deepak. Thank you very much for your talk, and we can't clap, but I can do this.
Thank you.
And yeah, so look forward to seeing all of you on Thursday, when we'll have a colloquium by Dipankar Banerjee on solar physics. Thank you.
Something much more down to earth.
That's fine. That's also up there, only the sun.
So. Of course. No, I didn't mean in any way disrespect.
Yes. Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.